Hi guys, today we're gonna read the story, The Blue Bouquet, written by Octavio Paz. It is found in the second chapter of Kerala Reader, the English textbook for students of class 10 in Kerala. It talks about a narrator who wanders through the Mexican landscape at night and gets confronted for giving his blue eyes to an odd person who needs them for his wife's blue bouquet. Come on, let's read. When I woke up, I was soaked with sweat. The floor of my room had been freshly sprinkled and a warm vapor was rising from the red tiles. A moth flew around and around the naked bulb, dazzled by the light. I got out of the hammock and walked barefoot across the room, being careful not to step on a scorpion if one had come out of its hiding place to enjoy the coolness of the floor. I stood at the window for a few minutes, breathing in the air from the field and listening to the vast feminine breathing of the night. Then I walked over to the washstand, poured some water into the enamel basin, and moistened a towel. I rubbed my chest and legs with the damp cloth, dried myself a little, and got dressed, first making sure that no bugs had got into the seams of my clothes. I went leaping down the green-painted staircase and blundered into the hotel keeper at the door. He was blind in one eye, a glum and reticent man, sitting there in a rush chair, smoking a cigarette, with his eyes half closed. Now he peered at me with his good eye. "Where are you going, Senor?" he asked in a hoarse voice. "To take a walk. It's too hot to stay in my room." "But everything's closed up by now, and we don't have any street lights here. You'd better stay in." I shrugged my shoulders, mumbled, "I'll be right back," and went out into the darkness. At first, I couldn't see anything at all. I groped my way along the stone-paved street. I lit a cigarette. Suddenly, the moon came out from behind a black cloud, lighting up a weather-beaten white wall. I stopped in my tracks, blinded by that whiteness. A faint breeze stirred the air, and I could smell the fragrance of the tamarind trees. The night was murmurous with the sounds of leaves and insects. The crickets have bivouacked among the tall weeds. I raised my eyes. Up there, the stars were also camping out. I thought that the whole universe was a grand system of signals, a conversation among enormous beings. My own actions, the creak of a cricket, the blinking of a star, were merely pauses and syllables, odd fragments of that dialogue. I was only one syllable of only one word. But what was that word? Who was uttering it? And to whom? I tossed my cigarette onto the sidewalk. It fell in a glowing arc, giving off sparks like a miniature comet. I walked on, slowly, for a long time. I felt safe and free because those great lips were pronouncing me so clearly, so joyously. The night was a garden of eyes. Then, when I was crossing a street, I could tell that someone had come out of a doorway. I turned around, but couldn't see anything. I began to walk faster. A moment later, I could hear the scruff of huaraches on the warm stones. I didn't want to look back, even though I knew the shadow was catching up with me. I tried to run, but I couldn't. I stopped short, and before I could defend myself, I felt the point of a knife against my back, and a soft voice said, "Don't move, Senor, or you're dead." Without turning my head, I asked, "What do you want?" "Your eyes, Senor." His voice was strangely gentle, almost embarrassed. "My eyes? What are you going to do with my eyes? Look, I've got a little money on me. Not much, but it's something. I'll give you everything I've got if you'd let me go. Don't kill me. You shouldn't be scared, Seno. I'm not gonna kill you. I just want your eyes. But what do you want them for? It's my sweetheart's idea. She'd like to have a bouquet of blue eyes. There aren't many people around here that have them. Mine won't do you any good. They aren't blue, they're light brown. No, Seno, don't try to fool me. I know they're blue. But we're both Christians, hombre. You can't just gouge my eyes out. I'll give you everything I've got on me. Don't be so squeamish. His voice was harsh now. Turn around. I turned around. He was short and slight, with a palm sombrero half covering his face. He had a long machete in his right hand. It glittered in the moonlight. Hold a match to your face. I lit a match and held it up in front of my face. The flame made me close my eyes, and he pried up my lids with his fingers. He couldn't see well enough, so he stood on tiptoes and stared at me. The match burned my fingers, and I threw it away. He was silent for a moment. Aren't you sure now? They aren't blue. You're very clever, Seno, he said. Light another match. I lit another and held it close to my eyes. He tugged at my sleeve. Kneel down. I knelt. He grabbed my hair and bent my head back. Then he leaned over me, gazing intently. And the machete came closer and closer till it touched my eyelids. I shut my eyes. Open them up, he told me. Wide. I opened my eyes again. The match flame singed my lashes. Suddenly, he let go. No, they're not blue. Excuse me. And he disappeared. I huddled against the wall, with my hands over my face. Later, I got up and ran through the deserted streets for almost an hour. When I finally stumbled into the plaza, I saw the hotel keeper still sitting at the door. I went in without speaking to him. The next day, I got out of that village. That was really odd, wasn't it? To get more useful content coming your way, please subscribe to our channel, Brain Blitz Audios, and click that bell icon for updates. Do like our videos and view them. Goodbye!